Like to call to order the City of Newport Beach Planning Commission meeting Thursday, November 17th, 2016. Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call.
All commissioners present, with the exception of Commissioner Zach, who's excused this evening.
Public comments on non-agenda items. Please limit your comments to 3 minutes. Any public comments?
Chair Kramer and members of the commission, my name is Jim Mosier. At the last two meetings, the commission has inadvertently skipped over the opportunity for the public to comment on the approval of the minutes. So I wanted to avail myself of that opportunity, which is now a non-agenda item, on the minutes that were approved at your last meeting. What I found peculiar about this is in the suggestions for changes, and this had to do with the dialogue about the Museum House approval or recommendation for approval at the November 3rd, October 20th meeting. One of the commissioners recommended amending some of the statements that had been made by a member of the public. It was not me. That member of the public had said some things that were factually incorrect, and the commissioner was recommending deleting those incorrect statements from the minutes. I personally think the minutes should reflect what was said, whether it was correct or not, but I wanted to point out, and I think this is an important point for you, incorrect statements come from sometimes from city staff as well as from the public. So if we were going to be correcting minutes to only include statements that were correct, I wanted to point out to you, and I'd hope to do this at your last meeting before you approve the minutes, on October 20th, those minutes, which was about the Museum House, there was a question about how the city currently has approved in Newport Center 79 more residential units than are allowed in the general plan. And the minutes say that in response to Commissioner Dunlap's question, Director Brandt stated that the general plan policies for Newport Beach, for Newport Center, allow the transfer of development and contemplated conversions within the statistical area. Now, it's true that the 2006 general plan allowed for the transfer of the development allocations within Newport Center, but there's no chance in the world that it ever could be read as contemplating conversions of those uses from one to another, especially from hotel rooms to residences. The reason I'm so confident of that is that a long ago planning commission recommended putting that provision in the 2006 general plan. It was discussed by the City Council on June 27th, 2006. They were very skeptical of it because it would be in conflict with the green light provisions that any new residences added have to count towards the green light totals. On July 11th, 2006, the City Council explicitly rejected putting such a provision in the 2006 general plan. And on July 13th, 2006, Commissioner Larry Tucker reported back to the Planning Commission, according to your minutes, that that provision had been nixed and removed. So while transfers are allowed, that the idea that they that the plan adopted in 2006 contemplated that those allocations would not only be transferred but converted is wrong, and if we're correcting the minutes, that would be removed, but I recommend that the minutes say what was said. Thank you.
Anyone else? All right. Request for continuances?
There are no requests this evening.
Consent items, item number one, minutes of November 3rd, 2016. Did you have something? Okay, go ahead.
Faster than I was. I'm not familiar with the Newport Beach process, so if there's another time for this during the hearing, please so advise me. But there's a conditional use permit for a assembly purposes for the building at 866 West 16th Street in Newport Beach.
Yeah, that's later on.
Okay. Yeah. Sorry, I'm unfamiliar with the process.
Sure. Okay. Consent items, item number one, minutes of November 3rd, 2016.
Make a motion to approve the minutes with Mr. Mosier and Mr. Commissioner Hilgren's comments.
All right. Is there a second? Okay. Any discussion? All right. Call to vote.
Motion carries 5-1 with Commissioner Ketting abstaining.
Public hearing items. Item number 2 is the Santa Ana Avenue Cottages, PA 2016-069. Staff, do you have a presentation?
Good evening, Planning Commissioners. This is a request for a major site development review and tentative track map for the construction of 7 dwelling units on Santa Ana Avenue. The project would include demolition of the existing 3 units that are located on site. The property is located at the boundary of the city at Santa Ana Avenue and Mesa Drive. This is an area that was recently annexed to the city in 2008. The land use of the area is multifamily, and what you can see on the surrounding area is that the properties across the street is the golf course, and the properties on the other side south of Mesa is actually county property, unincorporated area. And the area that's catty corner from the property is actually in Costa Mesa. The surrounding properties in the adjacent jurisdictions are duplex in Costa Mesa, and the county seems to have a single family and multifamily uses. The zoning also reflects the land use designation as being multifamily. Here's an oblique view of an aerial that shows that the surrounding area encompasses not only single family, but also some multifamily developments. The area is predominantly two stories. However, you can see basically up in this area up here, a newer development that includes multiple units that are 3 stories. Here's a view of the existing 3 units. It is has the garages in the front and the development in the rear. The project would be to demolish those 3 units and construct 7 new units. The units would encompass 6 being about 1,400 square feet and 1 being close to 2,000 square feet each, which would allow for two stories over 2-car garages, as well as guest parking on site. Here's a site plan that shows that access would be similar to where it's taken now from Santa Ana Avenue, and there'd be access through the property with the guest spaces in the rear. Here are the elevations of the development that generally shows that the architecture is somewhat of eclectic design, leaning more towards a Spanish element of a smooth stucco with some metal details. This shows some colored renderings indicating that they have some highlights at the exterior doors and that the window frames and the garage doors would be a darker color. The applicant does have a materials board that we'll distribute to you in a minute. Here again is a rendering. This, the top image showing from the west perspective shows from the front that there would be a low wall in the front of the structure to the right to allow for some open space for private open space. And here is the landscape plan that again will show the front setback being landscape in detail, as well as opportunities for private open space at the rear of the properties. This shows basically the fact that the project does comply with the existing regulations related to height being at 33 feet in height, front setback being maintained at 20, the sides and rear being at 5 and 25, and also the exceedance of the common open space and the private open space. And again, parking meets the requirements of the code, being that they get 2 parking spaces per unit, as well as 4 uncovered parking spaces. So lastly, we have a recommendation to adopt the major site development review and tentative track map. We have received some letters from surrounding property owners indicating concerns related to the height of the structure and that it is 3 stories in height. However, as I pointed out, that does comply with the regulations that are allowed in the code. When the city annexed the property in 2008, we basically adopted what the county had. So that regulation reflects was put on the books for quite some time. Also, the concerns were related to the safety issues of the intersection of Mesa and Santa Ana Avenue. Our traffic engineer, Tony Bryan, has been in conversations with the city of Santa Ana, who has been working with the county in trying to develop some strategies for improving that intersection itself. And Tony, I'm sure, can step in and provide you some additional details. But we don't feel that this project would be creating additional traffic that would create additional safety hazards to the intersection. So with that, I'm available for questions. Tony's here if you have questions about the signal issue, and the applicant also has a presentation.
Okay. Are there any questions for staff? Otherwise, we'll go to the applicant presentation. Okay. Applicant. Well, before we do that, let's do the report of ex parte communications. I've had no communication with the applicant.
None.
I have not had any.
I have. I met with the applicant.
I, too, met with the applicant.
Okay. Go ahead, sir.
Good evening. My name is Matt White. I'm representing the applicant for this project. Anyway, I've lived in Newport Beach since 1988. Went to Newport Harbor High School. Both my wife and I went to Harbor High School. We currently have two kids at Newport Harbor and one at Mariners Elementary. Thank you for seeing me tonight. One reason that I wanted to come up here and explain to you guys a little bit about the team and who is building this project and who would be. We all live in the community. The owner of the property lives in the community. I live in the community and just wanted to kind of come here and introduce ourselves. I've been building in Newport for about 20 years now in locations like the Newport Coast, Emerald Bay, and throughout Newport Beach. As a custom home builder, I've had the opportunity to work closely with individual clients and be directly involved with every single aspect of a new home building process. I just want to show you some of the homes that we have built in Newport Beach. This home here is on the little island of Balboa, built 4 or 5 years ago. This home here is on Balboa Island that we built and actually sold for one of the highest priced sales on Balboa Island, sold for almost $4 million in the middle of the island. A house here is on M Street on the oceanfront, a little bit more modern style, just to kind of show you our expertise in different styles of homes that we build. This home we actually built 12 years ago on Lido Island, and it still looks the same today. As far as our infill communities throughout Costa Mesa and Newport Beach, this project right here is called Nautica. It's actually just down the street from the proposed project on Santa Ana Avenue. We just finished this about a year ago. Again, timeless architecture, siding. The proposed project will have many of the same materials and style and quality that you see here. Another project here on the west side of Costa Mesa, a little project we built called Midtown. Again, I'm showing you these projects because the roofing here will be very similar to the Santa Ana cottages, with the composite roof material, the white stucco shutters, and the natural fencing, not PVC fencing, actual real wood fencing and materials that represent Newport Beach. Here's another elevation of Midtown. This is an elevation, again, very similar in style and what we're going to do on the proposed property. This project is right next, is on Tustin Avenue in Costa Mesa, right across from Newport Beach. Here's the interior. Again, what's been nice is I've been able to use all this experience that we've had from a custom home standpoint and put it into our communities. Here, I wanted to show this picture here because as far as the private spaces, they are small, but as you can see here, this is a 10-foot side yard, and it's very livable with the natural wood, the landscaping, so on and so forth. So to make a small space, we can make it very livable. Again, a little bit of redundancy here. I apologize. But again, just want to introduce you guys to the team. I would be the builder. Our architect is Sergio with Knitter & Associates. He is here tonight as well. Landscape architect and owner Adrian Brandis as well. Again, another view. I did want to point out as well, it is in an area where even more recently there's been some multifamily infill projects pretty close by. It is in a great location. A little close up there. I did want to, when I get to that point, as far as the parking and the current property and site, I did want to kind of explain a little bit as far as the parking and how our new project is going to benefit the neighborhood immensely. Again, we have a triplex, consists of 3,300 square feet. It was built in 1975. We worked with the staff every step of the way. I mean, Ben and Brenda were great and really helped us out because this is the first time that we've done this in the city. They took many, many calls, and we really do appreciate it. Per the zoning, we were allowed to build 8 units. However, our site plan features only 7, one of which is an ADA accessible unit. It's a larger unit, and it has a ADA parking spot for that unit. All zoning and building requirements have been fully implemented. And again, just want to reiterate, we are not asking for any variances at this time, or any variances. Here's our site plan again. As far as the open space, the requirement for this property is 525 square feet. The proposed open space that we have is actually 1,240 square feet. With regard to the private open space for each unit, depending on the size of the unit, we're in the 70 to 98 square feet. Our proposed private open space for this project is 116 to 230 square feet for each unit. And our building heights will not exceed 33 feet. Again, the living accommodations comply with all current codes and environmental standards. All building setbacks are in compliance. We have a 20-foot setback on the front. We have a 25-foot setback in the rear and 5-foot setbacks on the side. All improvements comply with the latest city water quality requirements and the Newport Beach Code, which is important. Just a little bullet point here, all new homes use half as much water as most of the existing housing in stock in California. Through the smart green building techniques, new homes are able to completely offset any new water demand. Our landscape, the cottage's landscape, is drought tolerant and complies with Newport Beach's green codes. I apologize, this is a little blurry. However, as you can see, we have drought-tolerant plants that take very little water, however, look very good and timeless. I do want to talk about the parking of the current situation. Currently, the 3 units have 8 total parking spots. Our proposed project will include a total of 18. Parking spots. And if you can see in this picture, I know it's a little blurry, and I drive to work every day and drive home. As you can see, there's the 4 spots here in front. However, if you can see right here off Santa Ana, one car parks here, another car parks off right in front. In order for them to get out of the development, they have to back out onto Santa Ana. And I've seen this happen, and it stops traffic. They back out and then situate, do a 3-point turn, and then they're on their way. With regard to our project, we have a turnaround in the back. Each home has a 2-car garage, so they're able to back out of their garage and come onto Santa Ana Boulevard in the right facing direction. Again, as Brenda had pointed out, here's our elevations. We're using these steel structures, there's shade structures, as far as decorative elements there on the front and the trees, and real wood fencing will really have a great elevation and fit perfectly into this neighborhood. You have the color board. I don't know if you guys have been able to pass it around. You have questions later, you can ask me on that. But as far as the garage doors, nice, good size metal doors. The trim will be a dark grayish black color. The roof is going to be a dark composite, similar to the photos that I've sent you. Entry doors are going to be colorful with reds and greens and yellows. The window frames are going to be actually pretty cool. They're going to be black window frames. Just a great timeless style that we've designed here. So with that, if you guys have any questions, I know that Mrs. Brandis actually would like to come up and say a few words as well. We can do that now, or that's okay. And we're available for any questions you guys might have. Thank you.
Thank you. I just wanted to, out of respect, be here and thank you very much for your time. And Brenda, thank you for jumping in Ben's absence. It's been quite a process. What we did when we first got the idea for this project is came to the city and said, this is the land that we have. What can we do? And the city said, this is exactly what you're allowed to do, and that's what we confirmed to, complied to. So we're actually feeling like we're adding value to the property. I am a residential real estate agent in the city of Newport Beach, and I think that this will add value to the surrounding properties. It will add revenue to the city, obviously. It's drought-resistant landscaping. It is friendly to the environment. And I also took the little extra step and went and spoke to seven of the neighbors. A couple of them, I suppose, wrote a letter that I saw, but I didn't get any objections from any of the neighbors that I spoke to. And conversely, I got two neighbors that were very excited about it. One specifically, my next door neighbor, who's also working on improving his project. And then another lovely woman on the corner who supports it very much. So again, thank you for your time. And again, sorry if I was redundant about anything, but do you have any questions for me?
Yes, Mr. White, or yourself, or the architect. I followed the concept. I followed the fact that you fit within the rectangle that you're allowed. My concerns are a few here. Starting with the unit number one, you said is an ADA. So is there an elevator in it? How do they get upstairs?
The bedroom is on. That's a good point. The ADA bathroom, and Sergio can actually speak to that a little better than I can.
ADA requirements are per CBC, California Building Code, and California Building Code requires that the unit has an accessible entry and exit to the unit and an accessible bathroom on the ground floor. Beyond that, there's no accessories that are necessary to the upper stories for residential.
So somebody truly handicapped in a wheelchair couldn't buy this, live there. They wouldn't be able to get upstairs.
Functionally, they would have to put a mechanical system in the stairs. There, I've seen them do that before, retrofit a unit.
Okay.
As far as CBC is concerned, the requirement per CBC is 10% of the units for a project like this, and this fulfills that requirement.
Mr. White, you indicated, you showed us some very nice-looking projects. Nautical, Midtown. You said this roof is going to be like those. It's not. You don't have metal standing seam. My disappointment is the architecture. It's just so bland on the outside, and there's no trim around the windows. It doesn't look anything like those other projects with a variety of faces on the elevations. It's got one bland, flat front. The sides pop out, I would bet, a foot, if that. And the colors are kind of the same. I mean, it doesn't look anything like the ones you showed us. even though you said the insides will be. So I was disappointed in that. I'm disappointed in what kind of stucco? Is it going to be blown-on stucco or troweled?
No, it'll be troweled on finish with the stucco. Yes.
Smooth.
Yes. Well, not quite smooth, like some homes in the high-end communities of Newport Beach, but it won't be a 1620. It'll be a smoother stucco. It won't be a popcorn stucco. But with regard to the architecture.
Our sample looked like it was going to be just blown on. That's why I asked. And the roof is not a variegated color. It's black. Not metal, not standing seam. So, I just thought the architecture was lacking something, especially on the street side. And I'm not telling you how to lay your floor plan out, but, boy, you're missing views out over that golf course. That's all. Last question. The only way you can get to that private open space is through the garage. It's 5 feet deep and however wide it is. So that picture I saw with nice chairs sitting out on a wood deck, how's that going to work?
Well, again, you're right. You do have to go through the garage. However, that's okay because now with today's garages, I mean, it'll be nice. It'll be clean. You'll be able to go at that space, but we'll still be able to access that space, but it is through the garage. However, it will be a nice space once you are out there.
And where's the wood fence? Is that between each yard?
Correct. Those are between each yard and on the front of the property.
Oh, I saw them white on here. It looked like the same kind of white ones you were saying it wouldn't be. That's all.
Those will be a painted white fence.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions? Yeah. Mr. Dunlap.
Thank you for meeting with me out there. It's hard to believe you've been doing this 20 years. It looked like you just got out of high school, but I guess that's has to do with my age, not yours. So,
thank you. I
like the fact that you've complied with everything. I think, you fit this onto the property well. You could have built 8. You're doing 7. Your open space is greater than what required. Side yards, I got a big issue in my neighborhood. They're actually less in Newport Heights than they are up there, or 4 feet. So I'm going to be in favor of this project, but I have to go along with my fellow commissioner, especially on that elevation facing Santa Ana, which would be the west elevation. I mean, I'm looking at it right now. I've got on the right side of the building, we've got 2 windows, and there's another one down low behind the tree there, and no window up high. It just seems very bland and stark and flat. I get it going down the sides. That's just kind of the way it is. You know, if there was any way you could embellish that street elevation, I would be totally in favor of that. But I like the idea that from a technical standpoint, you've met all the conditions. And I think that's it makes it our job easier up here. We're dealing with architecture instead of issues of variance and code stuff. So anyway, that's all I have to say.
Can I make a comment on the front elevations? Thank you, by the way. We can, if it's okay to work with staff, we can do a siding treatment and possibly add a couple more windows on that. I do want to tell you, as far as the metal structures, those will be hand-built, hand-forged metal structures that will really pop that architecture. I promise you that.
Any other questions?
Yeah. On that, what is that element? It doesn't provide shade. It provides a horizontal line. Well, what does it do?
I would say it's more of a decorative. It actually does provide shade, but it is more of a decorative element.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, let's continue here. Any other comments or questions? Okay. Yeah.
For Mr. Bryant, I was out on the site and I had some trouble parking, trying to find. Obviously, I wasn't a resident, I wasn't a guest, so I was looking for street parking. But there's a lot of red there in front of the property. And it's Santa Ana that is in charge of the street there?
It's actually Costa Mesa.
Costa Mesa
is the city.
We share mutually between our side and their side, or they take the lead, kind of like Irvine?
No, actually, that entirely Santa Ana is entirely within the city of Costa Mesa.
Okay. So there is no discussion on our end, really, if we could add some additional street parking, that would have to go to
them.
That's
correct.
And is there a significant, issue with accidents there because of the current residents, that the way they back out, or is it more just in that area, people running reds, and you know, it's a, it's always very busy after work.
You know, I tried to get some accident information from Costa Mesa. I was requesting it through emails. I hadn't received the accident data from them yet, but I have through emails, and I probably will join them in the discussions that Costa Mesa is having with the county. And they are looking at some potential improvements and changes to the signal operation. So I'll join them in that discussion.
And maybe when you discuss, see if there's a reasoning why it's all red there, if it's possible maybe to add a couple additional spots for on-street parking for, you know, other residents, or just the way that it runs. It looks kind of interesting.
Sure, I can bring that up.
Okay. All right. Let's open it up to public comments. Any public comments? No public comments? Okay. Nope. Is there public comments or no?
Hello, I live right next door.
What's your name?
My name is Tasso Nicolau. And I'm the neighbor to with the blue house right next door. And I'm also looking to develop my property. So I've gone through the city and I've gone through the permitting process right now. So I'm in favor of the project. I think the height's great. I don't see anything against increasing the density in the area. I think people are traveling so far to get to work every day. They'll be maybe closer to work, and that might reduce the density in the highways. The only thing that I ask for is that the I'd like to have the same kind of rights in terms of building ADA accessible the units themselves. There's not accessibility to the second floor. They have just accessibility to the one unit. I'd like to have some of those same rights when I'm going through my process. With regards to the traffic that's in the corners, and I think just being there, and there's really tall trees that are at each one of the corners, and there's a tall fence and at the kidding corners of each one of those properties. So as people are coming up there, they're not able to see kind of around the corner, and I think that's one of the causes of those accidents. I'm not sure exactly if those residents there could build those fences right up to the property line, and it just creates a blind spot. So if that was to be kind of reworked, maybe those trees would be cut down a little bit. I'm also talking to the neighbor, seeing if I could acquire her property and develop some units in that area. I think that corner lot right there, if those trees and shrubs were to be reduced, it'd be easier for people coming up to those traffic lights to be able to see where they're going. I think that might reduce the problems in that area.
Thank you. Any other public comments?
Hi, my name is Dunn Boyer, and I'm the homeowner adjacent to the property to the north. And I'm not in the business of, you know, shutting down people's property rights, but I must stand up for the property rights of my own. And to the north of my property, there's a 26-unit apartment building. My lot is 50 by 140. That apartment building is two stories high and draws to the 20-foot front setback. So it's about 120 foot of my property is flanked by the apartment building, two-story apartment building. Should a 7-unit, 3-story go in 5 foot to the south of my property, I'll be boxed in on both sides of the property at 100 foot on one side and 120 on the other side, and it'll be essentially a fire hazard. I would also cite that there are no 3-story units in that area. And even though they're digging down to get the garage in there and to get to reach the 33-foot height requirement, there's nothing to set the precedent for 3 stories. In fact, indeed, this project is completely surrounded by mostly ones. They're all SFRs. I on my personal property, there are 2 individual SFRs that are separated by about 25 feet, and to the south of them is a single-story SFR. I would also point out that, to your point, Mr. Eric Weiglin, as regarding the parking and why it's red from the intersection all the way to where the apartment building is. The reason why that is so that it doesn't obscure the view to the to that intersection when people are pulling out. And I would be love to have more parking in that area, but I also understand that people need to be able to see where they're going when they pull out, because people are blowing through that intersection quite readily, and the speed limit there is 45 miles an hour. So you got to be ready to pull out of your front driveway. And by packing in, by doubling the occupancy of that unit, you're going to tie up that intersection more than you think. And furthermore, you're going to create a large block in a very close proximity to that intersection, of which is about a little less than 100 feet. So I support this project if it's a two-story and however many units, you know, they can get in there for two stories. But at three stories, I think it doesn't fit the area, and ultimately it's a danger with that intersection. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other public comments? Okay, I'll close the public hearing. Does the applicant have any rebuttal or closing arguments? Bring it back to the commission. I'm in support of the project, but let me finish. I'm in support of the project, but I agree with my fellow commissioners, and whoever's going to make the motion, I would have a couple caveats. One is that there needs to be smooth stucco. And second is there needs to be enhanced architectural features on the front-facing parts of both buildings along Santa Ana Avenue. I think they can work with city staff, but we need to see some some enhancements there. Those are my two conditions that need to be incorporated into the motion. Any other comments from the commissioners? Okay. You want to make the motion, Vice Chair?
Yeah. Very well. Basically, I think I'm in support of the project the way it's designed. I just don't like the architecture. It's got to change. And one thing I've got to point out in your submittal to us, it shows the roof. Shows the roof. Almost like concrete shingles, not a flat composite. So I, you know, this is what I was given. I read this, I saw that, and I said, oops. So I think you've got to look at your details. The windows need to have better trim on them. The color, I'd like to see the color broken up a little bit, maybe on the panels that pop out. And as other commissioners said, the street side elevation needs to be improved. And other than that, and the stucco, it's got to be smooth stucco. That troweled finish blown on is going to pick up.
We haven't approved anything like that.
No, for a long time. Is there going to be an HOA? Is that required, staff?
They will be required to be CC&Rs. It's part of the project, yes. And we don't require that, but it will be needed.
And trash, will people roll it out to the street like they're doing now, or do they put it out of their garage? I notice there's room in the garage for trash bins, the wheeled kind. But is that something they wheel out to the street like the tenants are doing on that?
We have not regulated whether or not it'll be common trash collection or individual. It'll be up to the property owners.
Okay, because with a 20-foot wide garage, you can easily put your trash bins in there. I'll make the motion for approval subject to those conditions and bringing it back. And staff, you have trouble deciding, bring it back to us on the elevations.
Can I ask a question of the maker of the motion?
Go ahead.
Are you okay with the front, the primary entrance elevations and landscape?
Not the elevations. I am not. No, I wanted them to enhance them the way
along Santa Ana, right? But when you drive into the driveway, are you okay with those? And are you okay with the landscape? As it's
well, there's no landscaping on the inside,
right?
Unfortunately, yeah. There's a lot of movement going on with the windows and everything else there. Above the garages, there's another eyebrow that sticks out over the doors.
That we can live with. I can live with.
And you're okay with no landscape?
Well, there is a landscaping plan. I looked at it on the street side, but maybe there should be a tree in everybody's yard for that dog that's going to be out there.
I don't want to tough get into to that fit. Detail.
Okay. You want to add something to it?
I just think it's bland when you're in there. I'm okay with the architecture, but I think from a landscape point of view, it'd be nice to have some pockets, something to give it a little,
yeah,
little life, as opposed to just being a, looks more like an alley.
Okay, is there a second? Okay.
I'll second it.
There's the second. Before we call for the vote, the applicant, did you want to say anything else? Okay. Are you okay with the changes to the... Okay. All right, so let's call for the vote.
Motion carries 6-0.
Thank you. Congrats. Okay, next item is item number 3, Viewpoint Church Conditional Use Permit, PA 2016-144. Staff, do you have a presentation?
Yes. Good evening, Chairman, Commissioners. Melinda Whalen, Planning Division. So this is a request for a use permit for Viewpoint Church to be located in a building in northern West Newport, adjacent to the Costa Mesa border. The surrounding area is industrial and general office buildings. So the use permit is for the assembly use and off-site parking, which will be up the street in Costa Mesa. Includes a parking management plan and shuttle service. The property is developed with a building that was constructed in the 1960s for light manufacturing. There are existing two tenants in the building, and the church proposes to occupy one of the tenant spaces. The project includes, like I said, converting one of the tenant spaces totaling 5,000 gross square feet into the church use with offices and required restrooms, reception area, and the larger assembly area, which will be sectioned off by a full height wall per building code requirements due to the existing construction of the building. So within the parking management plan, the weekday use will include office and groups with a maximum of 32 people, and therefore the on-site parking is sufficient during the week. Saturday there will be small prayer groups with a maximum limit of people as well that will be provided by the on-site parking. And on Sunday and certain holidays, the larger assembly area will be utilized. And that's where the off-site parking agreement is for. It provides 75 spaces at an industrial site in Costa Mesa. And the shuttle service will be provided three times before and three times after the church service, and there will be parking attendants at each of the lots. So this shows the subject property at the bottom of the screen, and then the off-site parking up in Costa Mesa. And the on-site work includes improvements. They will maintain one storage shed towards the rear of the property. They will stripe 11 spaces for the church. The drive aisle does require an amendment to an existing easement, and this is conditioned to add additional area to meet the minimum code requirements. And then 9 spaces striped at the rear of the property. And this will be for the adjacent tenant, and will be used by the church when this office is closed. And it has compliant turnaround and drive aisles. So just a summary of the facts. There's an off-site parking agreement in place that's required to be recorded. The off-site parking will provide a shuttle service and parking attendance, and therefore provides convenient parking for the Sunday services. During the peak use for assembly on Sunday, the surrounding businesses are closed, so this diminishes the impact to the surrounding area. And it will also improve parking and access on site and provide sufficient parking for the weekly office and groups activities. So with that, staff recommends approval of the use permit, and I'm available for questions, and the applicant is also here available for questions. Thank you.
Thank you. Any commission questions for staff? Commissioner Hillgren?
Yeah, Melinda, a couple of questions. On handwritten page 6, just want to make sure the math works. Talks about 100 seats, maximum of 100 seats, seating plan for 128. And so I'm okay with 128 as long as it's parked, but I want to make sure that the report reflects what ultimately is going to happen.
Yeah, there was a little bit of confusion when the staff report was written based on the floor plan provided, but that was clarified, and I did send out a memo. There is plenty of parking for the 128 seats, and the area of the assembly needs to be limited with that full height wall per the building code, but they can fit that many seats in there if they provide the required aisle widths.
So there's a maximum occupancy. I just want to make sure the math works. I don't want somebody to come back and say, oh my gosh, you got 128 people here and you're only supposed to have 100. And on the shuttle, talks about 3 trips for a 14 passenger van, which gets 42 folks for 75 spaces. So they might have to run the shuttle a few more times anyway.
Yeah, they're going to follow up with the details of the shuttle, and that's a condition to be approved by the city traffic engineer. And I did hear that they would have parking for families with children on site, and then the shuttle service will be for other parishioners. Those details will be worked out in the final parking management plan.
And I suppose you could drop off your family and go park, right? And
correct.
Then, yeah, okay. All right. Are there any other places in the neighborhood to park, because people being people will find vacant spaces on a Sunday?
Well, in reality, there will be a lot of street parking available because most of those businesses are closed on Sunday.
Okay, great. Thanks very much.
Commissioner Dunlap?
On the seating, I'm kind of familiar with this because this is what I do in other cities for churches. Will the seating be fixed? Because that's an issue. What happens in churches, they get that seating requirement, and then they decide to clear out all the seats and kind of have a revival or whatever they'd like to do, which is all great. But then they have more people in there than by code and greater than the seating capacity because they can move the seats. So I need to understand from a building department point of view, will those seats be fixed?
Well, I believe they did address some of the building department's concerns regarding the seats with that full height wall that's proposed. So it will limit that assembly area. And they are still working with building and will be required to obtain building permits for that area.
Okay.
But maybe the applicant can answer.
Yeah, maybe they can address that.
Yeah.
Okay. Staff, what's the full height wall for? I'm looking at this site floor plan. What happens? It says open office area behind it. Yes, there you go.
Yeah, that was to section off the allowed assembly area. And they were going to put up a partial wall, but that wasn't sufficient to meet the building code requirements, and that prevents the seats from spilling over into that area.
As well as the circulation area?
That's correct.
Thank you.
Okay. Does the applicant have a presentation? And before that happens, let's do the report of ex parte. I have had no communication with the applicant. You went to church there? Oh. Okay.
I have not spoken to the applicant. You guys, ex parte?
Yeah, go ahead.
Hi, my name is Tim Palmquist, 1701 Skylark Lane, Newport Beach. Applicant, Landworks Development, board member, Viewpoint Church. I'd like to start off by thanking the City of Newport Beach and the opportunity to work with staff on this process. It's been going on for approximately 90 days. We have worked both with planning department on the circulation issues on and off-site parking, and then had the ability to work with planning, with building department and fire on the life safety issues. So relative to the parking, we have for our maximum use time is obviously Sunday mornings. We have 20 spots identified off on-site. We have another 75 spots identified off-site for a total of 95 spots. Our maximum chairs that we are applying for is 144, so I'd like to, Bradley, just make a quick correction there on the 128, and I will go into that in just 1 minute. But from a parking perspective, we know that our on-site parking, specifically 11 spaces dedicated to our side of the building, fits all of our weekday uses. And then on Sundays and holidays, we have an off-site parking agreement. On the building life safety fire issues, we have been working quite a bit with the building department on that. And we have identified the area that's in gray up on the screen as to being a maximum of 750 square feet. That area will actually be 744 square feet, fixed chairs. The wall is designed to prevent spillover. We have, they're shown on the site plan, a clear aisle of almost 5 feet all the way around the 144 chairs. I sat down with Simone this afternoon and we walked through the four exits that exist today, starting at the bottom of the screen. That exit will be left alone, moving up to the next one, which is kind of parallel to the first row. That'll be double doors exit sign with panic hardware. Moving to the second opening as it exists today, excuse me, the third opening as it exists today, that's also a roll-up door today. That'll also be replaced with a set of double doors, panic hardware, exit signs, occupancy load posted, and then the fourth door should remain as is. So that addresses the exiting to the north side of the building. To the south side of the building here on 16th Street, we have very wide circulation areas. I think it narrows down to 42 inches in one spot and 5 feet in the other spot exiting out to 16th Street. So to answer the other, the way we're going to delineate the 744 square feet so chairs don't spill over, we've made commitments to building that'll be carpeted or be some change of defining the space. We don't necessarily want to box it in with walls because we'd like to have easy exiting, but we are going to, so besides the wall in the back, we're just going to have that area carpeted to define that area. Then there was a question on the full height wall. And I think there was one other question I might have skipped over, but I'm available to answer any other questions you might have.
Go ahead.
Good evening. I think your 75 cars, I drove up there and looked around there. I think that will work. Sunday it'll work. Major holidays will really work. But that area is so impacted, you can barely find the street park space throughout the week. A lot of little businesses that have been split and they have other people in there, so they all have a few more cars. So my concern isn't for the big events on the holidays. It's the daily service or Bible study. 34 people, I think you said.
32, right.
How many staff work here?
So right now we have six staff, five full-time, one part-time. We put 7 on the application just for room to grow. In fact, in all of the operational documents we provided, we added, you know, kind of what we foresee the maximum being, giving us room to grow. So our biggest use is Wednesday mornings. We have a women's Bible study that meets only in the fall. It ends this year on November 11th. And we will have it arranged that staff would not come until after that study is over.
I guess my concern is you provide enough, 11 stalls for the people coming to the weekly Bible study, but not for your staff. Where do they park?
Well, that's why we're going to have them come after that study is over.
But every day you have Monday through Friday and Saturday, but Monday through Friday.
We have 6 staff coming right now every day.
Okay, but where do they park?
In those 11 stalls.
Well, the 11 stalls are for the people that come in for the Bible study.
That's why we're going to have the staff come after the Bible study is over.
So nobody will be there to open the door?
On Wednesdays. Right. Keep in mind some of the staff are in the Bible study, so that...
Okay, maybe I misread it. I thought it said Monday through Friday.
No, I think the only area that it's the tightest, our tightest use is a Wednesday morning women's study that's only in the fall. Staff is in that study, so we have plenty of parking on site for that, and the staff is going to show up in the afternoon on Wednesdays.
All right, and then I noticed behind the 9 or 10 stalls for the adjacent tenant. Twice, I went 2 different days, and every stall was taken. So they have a lot of people that park there during the week. I didn't go on the weekend.
So we contacted them. We went over and met with them. We understand they have 8 people. There might be some cars there that are on a permanent basis, but we understand they have 8 people there. And I remember the other question. I apologize. A question came up earlier if there is potential for adjacent parking. We have been in dialogue with the adjacent owner. He has about 103 spaces behind those units there that we're adjacent to. He asked that we would go survey the tenants as to what would be the probability of parking there. We talked to almost every tenant and got about a 75%, hey, we've got extra spaces in evenings and weekends. For legal reasons, we didn't do a write-up on that site. We found off-site parking further to the north. But I think it's clear that in evenings and weekends, there is definitely residual parking available at the adjacent site.
And I noticed in the staff report, you're still trying to get an easement to provide those 11 stalls? On the driveway?
We currently have a reciprocal easement with the adjacent owner. I was just explaining. We're in a good relationship with him. We need that easement expanded by a few feet, but we currently have reciprocal easements for that common drive.
But not for the parking?
No, we have an easement for our parking. It's just that we'd need a few more feet for ingress and egress. So we would need, as one of our conditions, to amend the existing reciprocal easement that we have.
And how is that going?
I see no problems getting that done.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, sir. Yep.
I don't have a problem with the Bible study, but Good Friday is a day that a lot of people don't take off, especially around there. They probably their small businesses probably working. Yeah. Is that going to be a big day compared
to... Last Friday, Good Friday, we met on the beach. We've had a history of meeting on the beach, non-amplified on the beach. So if that's a problem, we will...
For Easter, it said that it was, but Good Friday, you do as well?
This last year, Good Friday, service on the beach. Yeah.
All right, thank you. Let's open it up to public comments. Please come forward.
Good evening. James Dobson. I'm an attorney for the adjacent tenant. My residence address is 440 Harbor Island Drive in Newport Beach. First of all, we take issue with a number of the facts as presented today. They're, in fact, not accurate. I have a copy of the lease to my client, Starch Creative. They are, in fact, allocated 10 spots according to the lease, not 9, as was indicated in the submission by the planning official. Without getting too specific about the Newport Beach planning and zoning regulations. As I understand it, according to the various sections, 21.40, 0.20, and 0.30, there's a couple of things that I believe this application violates, which have not been addressed. The first is that that the off-street parking is supposed to be within 200 feet of the premises to which it's being connected. This is obviously much further away than that. And then in the table, 21.40-1, which is a part of the Newport Beach regulations, it indicates that assembly meeting facilities are required to have one per three seats. This is parking spaces, one per three seats, or for every 35 square feet of space to be used for assembly purposes. So, I mean, they're not even remotely close to that. The concern that we have about parking is that my client is an architectural and design firm and works 7 days a week and works night and day. They are regularly there in force on Sundays. They are regularly there in force on evenings and on holidays. They have eight employees at this time. The company's been in business now for 18 months, and they're growing very rapidly. By this time next year, I would anticipate that they would have 12 to 15 employees, and they're going to have their own parking issues. So the spaces that are allocated in accordance with my client's lease are not available to the church and will not be available on Sundays or holidays or other days. So those are essentially our parking concerns. Our other concern, of course, is noise. We have a very quiet environment where these architects and designers work, and as I said, on Sunday mornings and on holidays. And we're concerned, as I think it was Commissioner Hilgren said, that a revival of some kind may indeed be anticipated to be a fairly noisy event and would be very disruptive and create a nuisance to my clients and their lawful use of their premises. So at any rate, we strongly object to the issuance of this use permit because of parking violations that have not been addressed or resolved and because of noise concerns. Thank you. Yep.
Any other public comments?
Sure. Mr. Dobson, you said parking violations that have not been remedied. So the
parking issues that have not been remedied. They haven't violated anything yet because they're not there yet.
Okay, got it. Thank you.
Okay, any other public comments? Okay, please come down quickly.
Hello. My name is Kathleen Voorhees. I'm the building owner, and these are my tenants and my potential tenant. So my tenant that I have in now at the 864 space is news to me as of Monday night that they weren't happy about my possible new tenant. I've owned and occupied the 866 space for 20 years. I've never had parking issues or noise issues. I've always, in the 20 years that we've owned it, rented and leased 864. My husband's a photographer. We do photo shoots. Sometimes we have 30 people in there or more, 40 people at a time, loud music, lots of stuff going on, lots of cars. Everyone always has places to park. I do know in the last few years, the streets got incredibly busy. I have people from businesses that are across Placentia on West 16th that are parking. And on our street, on our side, and walking across. So it has gotten really congested. Since my 864 tenant has been in April of 2016, I've had two different events during the week, and they were 3 days long each, and they were from 8 in the morning till 6 at night, and I had 30 people in there. And it was a technical seminar, and I didn't have anybody complaining about no parking or noise, and that came from my tenant as well. I had a large photo shoot in there of probably about 40 or so people, and I, again, didn't get any complaints from my 864 tenant from any kind of noise. I am very sensitive to that. I don't want to make them unhappy, so it is a concern of mine, making sure that the noise is at a minimum during the week. Also, I'm up there quite a bit on the weekends, and I don't see anyone there on a regular basis. But having said that as well, I wasn't really offering up their parking. That kind of is their parking in the back. And it was under my understanding that the church was making other arrangements for their parking. I don't know if I have anything else to add to that, but I just wanted to let you know that I haven't had any trouble with parking or noise. And that has been since this tenant has been in since April of this year.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Can I ask you a question? The demising wall between the two spaces is made of concrete block, or is it drywall and studs?
It's drywall. It was a 10,000 square foot space, and then we divided it.
Any sound attenuation?
Any what?
Any sound attenuation in the construction, offset studs and those kinds of things?
I'm not sure. I don't know if I can answer that question.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Question while you're here. Since does the tenant next door, the architectural design firm, those are their stalls in the back?
Yes.
And nobody else can use them?
No.
According to the lease?
Yes.
Thank you.
That is correct.
All right. Let's move on. Any other public comments?
I do know, I'd like to just add one thing. I do know that when I talked to my 864 tenant, they were concerned that church people would end up parking back there and they'd have problems with that. And again, I've occupied my space for 20 years, as long as I've owned the building, and it actually works in reverse, because everyone that is going to the 864 space ends up parking on my side of the building, because I'm actually on West 16th and the parking yard is off of Babcock. So if you're coming to the building looking for the address, if you're looking for 864, you usually turn in on my side and park in my parking. I don't have people doing the opposite, so I don't really see that as being a problem for them.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Any other public comments? Okay, seeing none, I'll close the public hearing, bring it back to the commission. Is there a motion?
Mr. Chair, I want to touch back on that Good Friday thing that I was talking about. It's written in here in an amendment that says Good Friday would be set up with the Griswold Industries on handwritten 28. If you're saying you're going to be on the beach, can we just strike that? I mean, that's going to
be
a problem.
Well, no, they didn't say that. They said they've been on the beach in the past.
Yeah, is that something you're going to continue to do, or was it Easter that you're doing the beach?
Yeah, I was hoping to have a chance to rebuttal the...
Go ahead.
Okay, great. First of all, just like to address a couple points raised. At one parking space per three seats, we've asked for a maximum of 144 seats. That's 46 parking spaces that we need on Sunday. We have secured 75 spaces in our off-site parking agreement. So we have more than sufficient parking off-site with our 75 spaces. The 11 spaces that we have on-site is more than sufficient for all of our weekday activities. So between the, forget the adjacent tenant spaces for now, between our on-site that we have 11 spaces and our off-site for Sundays, we have more than enough spaces. I do want the commissioners to know that we sent an email to Starch Creative on the 2nd. We went over and visited with them 2 days later on the 4th and followed up with another email on the 7th. And at that time, they were very positive, mentioned no concerns, seemed glad to have us on board, appreciated what we were doing, and so on and so forth. So this is very recent information for me, but we have worked diligently for the last 90 days with city staff, with building and safety, with planning. We are confident that we meet all the conditions of the city and that we have sufficient parking on site and off site, and we look forward to a good relationship with the city and with our neighbor.
All right, thank you. Is there a motion?
Can we discuss that in further with the Good Friday?
I'd rather not.
I'm sorry?
I'd rather not at this point.
I think it's important.
I don't think it is. Why?
Because there's businesses around there that work on Fridays that are around there. And if you're going to have the whole capacity.
Would you like to respond?
Sure. In the past, we've met on the beach, and we would, if that's problematic, we can find many alternate spots for Good Friday service.
My concern is the Griswold Company. Do they fully know? Do they work on Fridays, or are they? Because I work for the government. The city here, I just asked, works for the government, and they don't have Good Friday off. I have to go into work. My wife works for the private sector. She gets it off, but. You know, it's kind of one of just that one day is just an interesting.
I think we'd be willing to relinquish.
I don't want to curb the service. I believe
let's
in this.
Let's do this. Since I think it's been established that our 11 spaces can accommodate 32 people, we would be more than willing to make it work for both the neighbors and the city and for ourselves. We'd be more than willing to have multiple Good Friday services, one on the beach, and if we had one at the offices. During business hours, we'd curb that to the 32 people.
I just want to make sure Griswold's okay with it going in, and then if they're not, then this is too late.
Cooperative on that, sure.
Okay,
absolutely.
Yeah, if the commission wouldn't mind striking that on the condition 5, just so that we can make that work today, and if we could come back to it, you know, maybe I would be happy to entertain it. I want you guys to have Good Friday, but I want it to work for the community too. And then just lightly, I don't want to go into this too far, but the 14 passenger van that you're using to get to Griswold, is
yes,
that going to be stored on site, or is that an off-site van somewhere?
No, that would not be stored on site.
Okay, thanks.
Okay.
Thank you.
Commissioner Lawler?
Yeah, I'd like to make a motion to approve a Viewpoint Church conditional use permit UP 2016-039.
Second. Is there a call to vote?
Can I
include the Good Friday?
No, it does not.
It's not.
Can I ask the maker of the motion? The applicant had asked for 144 seats,
yeah.
And the condition states 100. So can we increase that?
Commissioner Hilgren?
Yes, ma'am.
Chair, the condition has been changed with a memo I distributed as additional materials.
Oh,
so here it is.
It's already in there.
I didn't get that one.
Yeah, it's right here.
So it would be, limit the larger assembly area to Sundays, Christmas Eve, Christmas, and Good Friday when the off-site parking is available, and the assembly area shall have the maximum number of seats that the off-site parking will allow at one space per 3 seats and meet the occupancy requirements of the building and fire code provided in the building and fire conditions below.
I'm good with that. Thanks.
Okay, call to vote.
One question of the motion.
Sure.
And staff, condition 5 states the church shall have access to the 9 parking spaces to the rear of the property when operations are outside the business hours of 8 to 5. Apparently, that's not the case. So I guess we strike that. We heard from their lawyer that they had the lease on that and they're not sharing it. So how do you want to handle that one? That's page 19, number 9. It sounds like they haven't sufficient enough.
Right.
Yes, condition number 9 can be eliminated on the basis
okay.
that we could receive that testimony tonight that they actually are not available. Thank you.
We okay on the motion?
Yes, we can strike number 9. And for clarity for Commissioner Wiegand, the number 5, it says when the off-site parking is available. So if it's, by the way, it's written, if it's not available, then they can't do it.
I'm still going to make
already
a substitute
inclusive.
Substitute okay. motion to just strike Good Friday. The applicant is agreeant to it. It won't cause an issue with him, and then it will prevent an issue with the businesses nearby. He already said that he tends to do it on the beach side, so I don't see it being impactful. He's agreeant to it. It's going to help our neighboring businesses that do have to work that day and prevent an overflow issue or parking issue. I'm fine with everything that's been discussed.
Yeah. Well, there's a motion with a second, and there's a call to vote. So.
But I've asked for a substitute.
Okay, but is there a second for your motion?
Okay, that's all I have.
Is there a second or no? Okay, so your motion dies. Call to vote, please.
Motion carries 6-0.
Okay, we have a lot of items here, so I'm trying to get through this. Item number 4 is Olea Conditional Use Permit, PA 2016-142. Staff, do you have a presentation?
Yes,
Chelsea Craig will give a presentation in just a minute. And I also want to introduce Brad Miller, who is sitting in tonight for Wendy Joe from the Newport Beach Police Department.
Good evening, Commissioners. Chelsea Krieger with the Planning Division. The project is located at 2001 Westcliff Drive in a new commercial development that is currently under construction. The property is located in the Commercial General Zoning District and is surrounded by commercial uses to the north, west, and east. To the south of the property is the Coronado Apartments. The commercial center development was approved by the Planning Commission in June 2014 by Site Development Review, Traffic Study, and Lot Merger. The project is under construction with the current phase of the project, including the subject space, expected to be completed in February. The project was approved with 382 parking spaces and was constructed with 406 parking spaces. The parking was designed to accommodate up to 52 spaces for a restaurant use. The applicant is requesting a conditional use permit to establish a restaurant at the property with late hours, alcohol, and an outdoor dining patio. Late hours are defined as after 11 p.m. In this case, the applicant proposes a closing time of midnight every day. There is no live entertainment, dancing, or parking waiver proposed as a part of this application. The site is being developed with a commercial center, as previously mentioned. When completed, the project will consist of four commercial buildings and 406 parking spaces, including a parking structure. The structure separates the proposed restaurant and outdoor patio space from the Coronado Apartments to the south. The floor plan includes 1,783 square feet of interior net public area, and the outdoor dining patio is 489 square feet. The indoor space includes 99 seats in the dining area and 21 seats at a bar. The outdoor dining patio is shown with 30 seats. The original draft resolution includes a condition of approval recommended by the police department that the outdoor patio close at 10 p.m. And the restaurant itself close at midnight every day. The applicant requested that the outdoor patio hours be extended. And after discussion with the police department, staff has revised our recommendation to allow the outdoor patio to remain open until midnight on Friday and Saturday and close at 11 p.m. every other day of the week. The applicant is currently requesting that the Friday and Saturday hours be extended to include Thursday as well. There is an operator license also required as a part of this application. The applicant is here as well as a representative from the police department, and I can also answer any questions.
All right, thank you. Any questions for staff? Okay. Let's do report of ex parte communications. I've had no communication with the applicant.
None.
Quick question, staff, if I may, Chairman.
Go ahead.
It's called Olia.
Olia
Restaurant, not Ironwood.
Yeah, sorry about that. The original application was called Ironwood, but they changed the name.
No problem.
Okay. Does the applicant have a presentation? Please come forward.
Good evening. My name is Christopher Wadley. I'm representing the applicant. Obviously, what we're looking for here is just the extra hour for the dining and the restaurant that we're looking to do here in Newport Beach. This will be the third of three restaurants that have been done prior. The previous two are The Vine in San Clemente and also Ironwood in Laguna Hills. The reason you saw Ironwood is at the time we hadn't created the actual new emblem and logo for this particular location, but since then that has been done. So these are California wine-oriented type restaurant settings. They're a full-service experience, a fine dining experience, specialty menus. In the case, I know one of the concerns with the hours of operation is that, you know, you're worried that this might be type of a bar setting. I would note that 60% of the alcohol sales at the other two locations is wine, and then the ancillary would be the beer and liquor after that. So it's a full-service experience, again, with a specialized menu. We've got two other locations in operation. We've actually provided letters from the landlords to the planning staff showing that we've operated well with no issues, no violations, no concerns. The only other item that I would ask for is on the patio dining, we do like to have low-level ambient music. It is not live entertainment. It isn't anything that is other than to create ambiance at a low level to further the experience. If you have any questions, please let me know.
Thank you.
What, sure. What do you mean low level? That's a new one.
So I've actually dealt with several restaurant chains. There's a lot of restaurant chains that'll have kind of, you know, when you walk in and say like a fast casual concept, even where you walk in and they'll just have kind of a low level music kind of playing in the background to create kind of an atmosphere. Be it maybe a slow music or kind of a more current modern music, depending on what the use is. In this case, this is a more relaxed, kind of easygoing, full-service dining
subliminal?
Experience. Subliminal, no, not
buy
subliminal.
More wine.
Buy more okay. wine.
Thank you.
No,
I didn't
like
know
that.
What it was. Thank you.
Yeah, no worries.
Okay.
I have a question.
Sure.
So you're asking for the late hours, which is an additional hour, both interior and exterior now.
Correct.
And you want 12 o'clock Thursday through Saturday?
Correct.
And then that's on the patio?
That would be for patio and interior. Yes, so the additional hour would be for patio and interior.
But indoors you want it 6 days a week to 12 o'clock, right?
Correct.
Okay.
7 days a week.
So when's the last call in a 12 o'clock shutdown?
So I actually have the operator here. And so they could answer that question specifically. So I'll
okay.
just real quick.
Hello, my name is Russ Bendel. I'm the owner of Vine and Ironwood. And to answer your question, if we were going to be closing at midnight, we would do like an 11:30 last call. So that way, by the time people have 30 minutes to finish their beverages and food, they'd be able to.
So, but if someone walks into the restaurant at 11:31 and wants to sit down and have dinner, you're going to feed them dinner, right? Because you're not closed yet.
We take reservations all the way up until 11 o'clock. So we would want people to be able to have that extra hour to complete their dinner.
No, that wasn't my question. My question is, I walk in at 11:31. You've already had last call. I order dinner and I want to order a drink. Do I get a drink?
You would not be able to have a drink.
At 11:31.
No.
Right. So if I want to order a $100 bottle of wine with a $100 dinner, you're going to say no.
Yes, we're going to follow. Okay, follow the rules, whatever
okay.
we have to do.
Well, I mean, they're your rules.
Yes.
I mean, presumably, if we allow it to 12 o'clock at night, you could at 11:59 make your last call.
So I'd pose a question: has this been a dilemma at the other two locations?
No, that's
it has not.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Any other? Okay, let's open up to public comments.
Good evening. My name is Angela Courtright. I'm a local resident for 30 years, local business owner for 20 years. And I'm here because I got to know Russ, the operator, when he was the managing partner at Fleming's here in Fashion Island, however many years ago. He comes from a long family of really successful restaurateurs and business people. And his new ventures, which are Ironwood and The Vine in Laguna Niguel and San Clemente, respectively, are quality dining experiences. They're not rowdy bars. If you haven't been, you got to go. I'm sure that this will be much the same. Any concerns with regards to noise, rowdiness, parties, dancing? I'm kind of disappointed about the dancing, actually. But anyhow, I think that those can be dissuaded. And then also just knowing that you're dealing with a professional who's been generations in the industry and will do nothing but add value to the community and a great experience for our residents and hopefully destination for more revenue for the city. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Anyone else? Okay, seeing none, public comments is closed. Bring it back to the commission. Is there a motion?
Mr. Chair, can I ask a question?
Sure.
So originally the staff wanted 10 p.m. close on the patio, But with the applicant asking for 12, we've come to a compromise somewhere in between. Is that kind of what this new change?
We did recommend a revised condition. The applicant is still asking for a little bit more.
More.
They want the extended hour on the patio extended to include also Thursday, where we had just revised it to include Friday and Saturday.
So 12 a.m. on those days and then 11 the other days.
Correct.
That was staff recommendation, police concurrence.
Correct.
Even though originally you said 10 o'clock across the board, they wanted 12 across the board. This is kind of a midway point. Okay, thanks.
It's me.
I thought we were going to oil up your microphone for tonight.
I'm going to bring some WD-40.
All right.
I'm going to make a motion.
Fantastic.
I knew you'd appreciate that. And I'm going to add to the motion that I like where this is tucked in. It sits in the middle of a commercial complex. It's surrounded by commercial properties, has a parking deck between it and the adjacent residential. So I'm comfortable with the extended hours to midnight on Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. And I'm okay with outdoor music as long as it's within the decibel characteristics that are city code. So those modifications, I move that approved conditional use permit number UP 2016-038.
Second.
All right. Any additional comments? Called up for vote. Clerk.
Motion carries 4-2 with Commissioners Wigand and Dunlap voting no.
Mm-hmm.
Could I make a comment?
Sure.
I'd like to, the applicant, I've heard about your restaurant. I think it's a fine restaurant. I think you'll be successful. It's a neat center. I'm glad that got developed, and I hope you're successful. My reason for voting no is because I don't think anything good happens serving alcohol after about 11 o'clock. It has nothing to do with you or the wonderful food you're going to be serving, but sometime I'll have a conversation with the police. It taxes our police department, even though Uber seems to be traveling around with all these people that are intoxicated in it, but it's a neighborhood concern. So again, I hope you're very successful.
All right, thank you. Okay, next item number 5, Lido Marina Village offsite parking, PA 2014-002.
Mr. Chair and members of the Planning Commission, this is the review of an off-site parking arrangement consistent with use permit 2014. The Commission approved the Lido Marina Village revitalization, including a parking waiver and an off-site parking agreement. Condition number 4 of that conditional use permit required this review because the applicant is seeking off-site parking. Now we have a location for it. Just to kind of refresh the Commission's memory, Lido Marina Village is shown here. Newport Boulevard is on the left of the Via Lido is on the bottom. And so it's that complex around Via Porto of small buildings being renovated for commercial, office, and some restaurants. So this is kind of the basic layout of the uses that are undergoing renovation and the various land uses. Again, the Commission reviewed and approved this back in 2014. The off-site parking arrangement at this point in time is up at Hogue Health Center, which is with the Star up on Superior Avenue, 540 Superior. So they would have 100 spaces up through November 30th of this month, and then 200 spaces after that, and then there would be a shuttle that would take the car employees down to the site, which is located here with the Star. And the return route would take it right back up to the site. So this is a picture of a graphic of the off-site parking. These are two parking structures that are bubbled, and the shuttle would come in, pick up employees, and then it would take it out here back to Superior. The van would show up here down at Lido Marina Village and come in off of Via Lido through Via Porto, picking up and dropping off employees in front of the Elks Lodge at in a red curbs area, and then extending back to Newport and back up to the site. So we've reviewed, and the shuttle program operationally should work. It basically will run three times an hour. The hours of operation noted in the staff report are during the peak periods when the employees will need it. I also wanted to kind of show some of the parking rates, and in our recommendation, you'll see a recommendation for a condition to change the rates. Specifically for these offsite, these parking passes. The parking passes are $85 for employees, and we felt that that would be a disincentive to use this program because it's actually a voluntary program. And if they're not using that, then they're parking in the streets. And so that was one way to affect behavior. We do have some changes in conditions that I'd like to go over with you. These are just the basic rates for parking today for the public to use the spaces and the monthly rate of $85. And I want to make a point. In the staff report, I noted that, if the employees didn't want to take advantage of this system, they could park in Findlay Tract or other areas, and that's not really what I meant. What I really meant was is that, employees might choose to do that, and that wouldn't be endorsed by city staff. The intent of having this program is to get the employees into these parking spaces and off the streets so that the patrons can use it or residents can use them. So we have a couple of revisions that we'd like to do. One I presented in a memo that I've emailed to the commission, condition number four, but I'll go in order here. I've presented some draft changes at the podium here. Condition number two, again, is in writing. It's available for the audience. And this is the condition originally that would modify the $85 monthly rate for employee parking passes. Rather than do that, we wanted to kind of try to incentivize the use. And so we've got condition number two, that they shall provide some incentives for the tenants and employees to encourage the use of the parking shuttle program, providing discounted rates for longer term passes, discount to purchases for employees in the shops, monthly parking passes with an auto pay option, there would be another discounted rate. Raffles, which would also incentivize the use of the shuttle. So what we wanted to do is replace condition number two that would modify the $85 rate with this incentivized program. The second one is a modification to condition number four, which is in the separate memo that I sent earlier. And this would be the one about the monitoring. The condition there, I set it up to come back to the commission in a year after being in operation, and that was really actually a draft thought and wasn't what we were thinking. What I'd like to actually do is replace it so that we have a parking management monitored by the applicant and the community development department on an ongoing basis or as determined by the director. And the director may require review by the planning commission if we have problems that occur and that are not adequately remedied by the applicant, so that we have that change. The change to condition number eight is a very minor one, which is really put some timing into that condition, and that's the requirement is that the municipal code requires a parking covenant to be recorded that reflects the parking arrangement between this site and the off-site lot, and it just needs some timing, and so the change would be prior to the issuance of a certificate of occupancy for 3450 Via Porto, which is the Nobu restaurant. Then that would be the additional language to that condition, and so that the covenant would be required before that point in time, and that point in time is when Nobu starts up. That's the largest tenant that's there and has the most employees, upwards of potentially 60. We have two additional conditions that we would like to add. By the way, these changes to the conditions, I have vetted them with the applicant and they're agreeable, so but just to continue, condition number 10 would read, the applicant shall require each tenant and employee to place a sticker on his or her vehicle that identifies the vehicle's relationship to Lido Marina Village and allow for enhanced parking management and monitoring. And it goes on to talk about where that sticker should be. And the purpose of that is just really if employees are parking where they're not supposed to, that we'll be able to see them. If they're parked legally, they'll actually be able to park there. But that'll help us monitor the parking to see if people are parking where they're supposed to. And if they're not, then we may bring it back and make some changes. So that just helps us in the monitoring effort. The last condition, number 11, all new or amended or extended leases shall include language that strongly encourages the tenant and employees' use of the available parking, again, which is the combination of the on-site and the shuttle and the off-site, and then additional language that strongly encourages the participation in the incentive programs that I discussed in condition number two. So we would hope that those would get incorporated into the ongoing relationship between the applicant and their tenants. To encourage the use of the shuttle. Now, clearly, off-street parking with projects is obviously the most the preferred method to have employees park so that they're out of our neighborhoods and the street parking is available for patrons. This is a voluntary program. We'd like to see if this program will work. The applicant has a very advanced parking system and passes, which will help regulate that. And you know, we want to see the project come forward, get occupied, and we'll monitor the situation. If we have problems, we'll work with the applicant. So we want to definitely recommend approval with these changes, and staff is available for any questions. The applicant is also here for any additional thoughts or questions that you have of them. And that's it.
If there's no questions, maybe we can go into the...
Real quick one.
Of course.
Jim, have we ever implemented a parking arrangement, I'll call it, with the covenants, conditions? We got, you know, there's a lot going on here, and I think it's comprehensive. You've worked on it hard. Is there anything else similar in the city we've done? And if so, has it been successful?
I've been with the city for 16 years. I can't recall anything like this.
I haven't either, and I've been around almost as long.
The Irvine Company provides shuttles for their employees from time to time at various different shopping centers, and it's a voluntary thing that they're doing to help mobility in the area and help reduce congestion. I think that's a good thing, and you know, they monitor it, and it's fine. But beyond that, nothing that we've regulated with a use permit.
Okay, thank you,
Mr. Chair. Sure. Who does the monitoring? It sounds like a staff person drives around and looks at it at various hours.
We
you said
definitely
when
do that.
We go out and monitor it.
Well, we do drive-bys. We also react to complaints that might come that occur. You know, as indicated in the staff report, we've had some complaints of some folks parking in the Finley track. Not entirely sure who those folks are. Reports are that they're walking back to Lido Marina Village, so I don't know if they're contractors, employees, or patrons. And that's part of the difficulty in enforcing this, and hence why the sticker program that the applicant has proposed would help us identify folks who are parking where they're not supposed to. So, again, it's staff, public works staff has been out in the Finley track looking and checking license plates and doing a variety of things. And so it's an ad hoc basis, but I think as after Nobu comes in, we're going to actually probably go out there several times, you know, and take a look and obviously monitor any calls that come in.
Okay. Does the applicant have a presentation? Let's do the report of ex parte communications. I have communicated several times with the applicant.
None.
Thank you. I'm Lindsay Parton, president of DJM Capital, the owner of Lido Marina Village. I think our only comment is staff has worked hard to make what is a relatively complicated agreement tenable to us as the owners, and we appreciate all the work with staff. And if there's any questions, we're happy to answer them, but we're in support of the condition of the way it's been modified. Thank you.
I need to disclose, I did go to their opening.
Okay, let's open up general public comments. Mayor Gardner.
I'm Nancy Gardner. We have a couple of things like this in Crown Del Mar, not exactly, but where the business buys the parking passes for its employees and they're supposed to park in the public lot and they don't want to walk the couple of blocks. So I think the employee sticker is a great way, because I can assure you that you don't necessarily need city staff out there. The neighbors, if they know they can identify them, and they see a lot of them, they'll be calling, and it will be a nice enforcement way to identify them, which we don't have right now.
Chair Kramer and members of the commission, my name is Jim Mosier. I have not had time to study this in detail, but seeing the initial slide, I just had a question about the arrival and departure zone for the 20-passenger shuttle bus, shown by a big star here, which is on handwritten page 64. And I was just curious how literally the public is supposed to take that giant star, whether the bus is actually supposed to be parking in that area or actually parks in the street nearby. Because where the star is, I thought one of your previous approvals, that area by the Elks Lodge, that had been dedicated for a previous shuttle service that's called the Downtowner, little shuttle cars. And I thought that area had been restriped and that was their charging and storage area. So I have trouble visualizing how the big bus is going to park on top of that, but perhaps the star is not intended to be taken literally. I don't know.
Any response to that or not?
Sure. There, it, it, the area right there is a red curb space, and it wouldn't be blocking or hindering the access to those spaces. And so the van will be there for a short duration to offload and onload employees, and then it will move right along. And so we did look at that. We didn't feel that it was a significant hazard or a nuisance. So, we should be able to operate all those uses in that area.
Thank you. Any other public comments? Okay, we'll close the public hearing. Bring it back to the commission. Is there a motion? Make sure your mic's on.
Yeah. I'll make a motion to approve as amended with the conditions that Jim just went over.
Second.
Any further discussion? Please.
I'd just like to say to the applicant, I hadn't been down there in a while, and I walked it in two different days, and your retail businesses look great. They're all new. Had never heard of them before, so that's fun. Hope they're making sales. Thank you.
Call to vote.
Motion carries 6-0.
Congratulations. Next item is new business, item number 6, Newport Beach Sustainability Plan, PA 2016-120. Staff, do you have a presentation?
Good evening, Commissioners. Patrick Alford, Planning Program Manager. Basically, the City Council was presented the draft sustainability plan in April at a study session, and in June of this year, they directed the plan be sent to the city's major commissions and committees for review and comment. The sustainability plan was prepared by a citizens committee chaired by former Mayor Gardner and Gene Watt, and I see that former Mayor Gardner is in the audience, and she may want to comment on this. Basically, it is a unified plan to make the city more sustainable. It would integrate such practices in all city functions, and the city would take the role of promoting such practices in the private sector. The plan has a number of elements, education, building development, waste reduction, transportation, energy, water conservation, water quality, and urban outdoors. Obviously, building and development would be the main focus of concern for the Planning Commission, but as you can see, that would probably also touch on energy, transportation, water conservation, quality, and the urban outdoors. Each element has programs and procedures. These include incentives, promotion and advocacy, partnerships, the city's infrastructure and services, data collection analysis, and, of course, land use and development. Under incentives, plan proposes potentially waiving or modifying fees for sustainable projects, fast-tracking permit processing, providing incentives through awards and recognitions of quality projects, and more flexible regulations. Under promotion and advocacy, it's a multimedia approach that would involve, of course, brochures, city's website, social media, and presentations before various groups. Also, staff training and accreditation. So city staff would play the role of an advocate for sustainability practices in our day-to-day functions. Under partnerships, it calls we're working with utilities, educational institutions, nonprofits, and the private sector. And as far as the city's infrastructure and services, calls for LEED qualified buildings, retrofitting existing city buildings, continued water quality control and conservation measures, and waste reduction and disposal reductions with the overall goal of zero waste model. Data and collection analysis, we require annual reports on by all city departments, periodic energy audits, and the city's commissions and committees would be required to submit progress reports on their efforts on promoting the elements of the plan. And, of course, the focus on land use and development, there's a emphasis on alternative transportation to make alternative transportation other than automobiles to make the city pedestrian and bicycle friendly. Sustainable practices and landscape design and materials, calls for addressing the balancing of jobs and housing in order to reduce trips and other impacts associated with an imbalance in jobs and housing. Alternative energy, including solar. The urban design features, again, these things you might see on both on land use decisions and projects to provide the connections and the alternative transportation methods, the alternative energy, and so forth. And then finally, open space and natural area protection calls for protecting all those areas that we currently have and enhancing them where appropriate. So basically, all these things under land use and development would probably be under the review of the commission if the plan were adopted. So just to facilitate discussion, we offered some suggestions. First of all, is there's the need for the plan or continue with current state and local practices. The plan emphasizes a voluntary approach, and is promotion, advocacy, incentives only or sufficient, or should mandates be considered? As far as the goals of programs, was there anything that was left out? Is there anything that should be taken out? So that concludes my presentation. It's basically the commission's pleasure. We can receive your comments individually or as a group. You can defer it for action later or direct staff to determine some type of statement that you could act on as a body. We have taken this to other committees and commissions. They generally have not taken action as a body, but have expressed comments of individual members. And we would convey any comments that we receive either now or from you through other communications to the City Council.
I'd like to hear from Mayor Gardner. You could give some background on all this and really provide more context.
Yes.
I think it'd be helpful.
This started with two workshops, and those attending included the Irvine Company, Hoag, Southern California Edison, Fusco Engineering. They do a lot of work with the city, as well as the Green Building Council, the Orange County Chapter, Newport Bay Conservancy, and the people that you would expect. And out of that came a basic plan. And the philosophy was, as I say, and as Patrick explained, very much carrots. There are no sticks in here. We're not beating the donkey. We are trying to encourage the donkey. And we don't consider, of course, the city really a donkey, but using that metaphor. And then we took it to the Newport Beach Chamber of Commerce because we wanted to be sure that it was not considered business unfriendly. We don't single out business, and except in one case where we encourage the city and the chamber to work together on a Shop Newport program, but we wanted them to be sure, and they reviewed it first with their government affairs committee and then with the board, and they not only approved it, but their executive director came and spoke in favor of it when we presented it to the council. I think the basic question is why a plan? The city does a lot, and there are two really basic reasons. One is that with the plan, we become more efficient. Everybody's on the same page. Right now, there are redundancies in what we do, and there are gaps. This will help us become, as I say, much more efficient, which is always a welcome step. And secondly, it's an easy way for us to get the credit that we should have for what we do. And it's not only just the street cred of saying to all the other cities in Orange County, yes, we too are sustainable, but it's also a financial aspect to it. That we, since I think about 2002, this city has gotten something like $10, $20 million worth of water quality grants. And grantors now are starting to look at, do you have a sustainability plan? And that can be the bonus points when you're competing against other cities, or it can be the negative points. So there are some very good reasons for us to do it. And also, there are, some cities just do it because they feel like it's the right thing. But I think we're a very practical city. And if you look at these things nowadays, there's a real economic benefit. This city, this civic center, whatever your feelings were about how it came about, if you compare it to our old City Hall, we use one-third as much energy. Well, that's money saved. The same with our water conservation. And for our private sector to work with them and encourage them, we say build in flexibility. We're not saying in this plan you have to build beyond state standards. But we're saying if you want to, We want to be sure we're flexible enough and we don't interfere with you. And why would you want to? If you're a commercial builder, you can get better rents nowadays. There's a building out by the airport. It's getting $360 a square foot as opposed to $1.50 from its neighbors just because it went up to a LEED standard. They find that they have lower absenteeism. It's not just the energy savings. When Lockheed built a LEED building up north, their absenteeism dropped by 18%. So there's some very practical reasons for this. But what we tried to do with this is, as I say, to make it a positive approach, not a negative approach, not a punitive approach, and to incorporate the best of the city. So we tried to get as many people participating from different sectors, which is why we had people like the Irvine Company contributing their knowledge and their energy and enthusiasm to this.
Questions? Mr. Kedding?
Yes, I've got to tell you, this was delightful to read, and I appreciate all the time you put in. This is something that is coming. It's been here, but this organizes it a whole lot better. I don't know how the staff or your committee wants us to comment on it. I've written notes on quite a few of the paragraphs, things to think about. And I could pass this on, keep going. Then we don't need to probably debate it in my mind.
Yeah, I mean, here's my thoughts. This is the first time that the Planning Commission has seen this. And, you know, I went through it on a basic level in terms of review. And I think it would be helpful if this was placed on the agenda for the next meeting that we have, so that at that meeting we can provide insights or comments or whatever to staff, so that we can kind of live with this document for a couple more weeks, because there's a lot more that I would like to comment on, because I think in general it's an excellent document and very important. So I want to make sure that we're respecting the time that has already been taken, and not just kind of give you a few comments and then move on. I think it really deserves a lot more attention. And so I think this is a nice introduction tonight. And then at the next meeting, we can provide more thorough comments. Does that sound fair to everyone on the commission? Okay.
If I could.
Go ahead, Commissioner.
Thank you, Nancy. Job well done. I was at the Irvine Company when we first started looking at sustainable back 18 years ago when it was just getting popular. And a lot of us went to get our LEED certificates. I missed it by one point, so I still grieve over that. But anyway, I will comment in writing, and then I think based on the chairman's comments, we'll come back at our next meeting. One thing that I didn't see in here, and it's not a mistake because it prompted my interest in it, which is solar water. And I'd be more than happy to discuss that with you. I have it on my house, and it's very inexpensive, and it's a great way to heat water in a recycling system. So anyway, but thank you. I really enjoyed reading it.
Any other comments? Okay. So I think that's what we'll do then. And Mayor Gardner, if you could be here at the next meeting, I think that'd be helpful. And anyone else that you want to bring along? And if there's any additional presentation beyond what staff has prepared, that might be helpful. Okay. Does that give enough guidance to staff? Okay. No, there's no motion needed. Yep.
I'm curious, do you meet regularly with this group, or once you produce this, now you're just out on the sales pitch?
Okay. All right.
Thank you.
Okay. Next item is item number 7, motion for reconsideration. Item number 8, community development director's report.
So the first item on here is our typical update on the LCP. We can almost remove that since we are so close to having that, we are basically certified, finalizing our last steps before we can actually start issuing our CDPs. But on to council items. In regards to the museum house, the Airport Land Use Committee did consider the museum house today and did approve the that project. So that is on target to go to the City Council on November 29th for the first hearing. Looking at next week's City Council meeting on the 22nd, the Council is hearing some of the items that the Planning Commission has already considered, one being 191 Riverside, as well as the Newport Coast Development Agreement. Our next Plan Commission meeting is December 8th, and I will add the sustainability plan onto that meeting. I think they'll do well for that night. And if any of the commissioners have any requests on how to be prepared to review the sustainability plan, feel free to give Patrick a call. As we have already decided upon, the December 22nd and January 5th Planning Commission meetings, we will be canceling those. I have emailed about the potential of having a January 12th meeting. We have a very anxious applicant that is wanting to have a meeting sooner than later. I've heard from a couple commissioners, but I have not heard that we have a quorum as of yet. So if you are available January 12th, please let me know.
What project is it?
It is a use permit to establish restaurants with alcohol service at the View Newport project on Balboa Boulevard. That's a new mixed-use project next to Crab Cooker. So our other January meetings, I want to point out we are having our next Mariner's Mile public workshop on January 26th. As you know, the last Mariner's Mile workshop, we made a joint meeting with the Planning Commission, and that allowed the commissioners to basically act as commissioners at that meeting, and you had the ability to express your comments at the end. So the question to the Planning Commission is if you want to have that similar format for the January 26th meeting. So I want to give that some thought and let me know. There's certainly time to do that.
Is there any way we can consolidate the January 12th and the 19th meetings into one of those two dates?
Well, that is the question for the applicant of U Newport. It's like, it's just one more week. Why not just wait to the 19th?
Yeah.
Yeah. I see your point of not wanting to just have one meeting just for one project, and I share that concern. So
that and is I'm okay our... pushing the 19th into the 12th, too.
Yeah.
So. We can certainly do that.
Well, that never happens, though. Kind of a rebel.
So, yeah.
It's another late-night alcohol, music, patio, drinking.
That's our deal. That's what we're going to do.
So I'm going to continue to consider the View Newport, how ready it is for hearing. And I understand your concern about not wanting just one item.
Yeah, so let's try to consolidate them into either 12th or the 19th.
Sure. And that's all I have.
What's the Harbor Commission?
The Harbor Commission wants to share with you their mission of the harbor, basically, and to better communicate between their interests of marine-related independent uses, and in particular to kind of share some ideas about Mariner's Mile, and that's kind of how it came up. So this is kind of a communication link that they're establishing with the commission itself.
Yeah, I actually talked to Joe Stapleton about that a couple months ago, so that's the outcome of that.
I had a question sitting on Coast Highway today, looking over where we approved that little retail residential project where Bayside comes into PCH. What's the status on that? They had a tower they got approved by the Coastal Commission, and I can't remember the name of it.
Back Bay Landing.
There you go.
Right.
Is it alive?
Yes. What the city approved was basically the legislation for that project, the general plan and the zoning code. Now they have to come back with the actual project. They have not submitted the actual project yet.
Okay. Very good.
Okay. Announcements on matters that Planning Commission members would like placed on future agenda for discussion, action, or report. Any requests for excused absences? Anyone? Commissioner Hilgren's gone on the 12th. Okay. All right. This meeting is adjourned.